there. Thank you for checking out this edition of R&R's Ask the Expert. Today, I am very excited to be joined by Phil Rosebrook. He is the president of Business Mentors and also a founding partner of RestorationTrainingOnline.com. Phil specializes, he's a consultant in the restoration industry, specializing in operations changes, building corporate infrastructure, defining market strategy, developing measurements for accountability, and creating sustainable business plans. Lots of things. So I'm going to toss it right over to Phil. So part of this conversation is going to be based off of a couple articles that Phil has in the March and April editions of R&R, and it's also on the website, of course. Every year, Phil does this great article where he judges his trend article from the year before and scores it, essentially gives himself A through F grades. So that was in the March issue, looking at his predictions for 2020. You can imagine how that looked, year of COVID, couldn't predict that coming. And then in the April issue, he's also gonna have an article that's his predictions for 2021. So we're gonna jump right in. And Phil, I wanna talk first about your 2020 trends review. What is your overall take on that? Of course, no one could see the pandemic coming. So what do you think about 2020 overall?
Well, so 2020, if you look at the kind of the essential elements of what happened in 2020, I think a lot of what I had foreseen, I'm a student of the industry, and I just sit and I look and I get to see it from kind of the big picture from 1,000 feet. And so I look and say, okay, where's the influences? What's happening in companies? And so, a couple of things. The first thing that comes to mind is when Mark Springer, president of RIA, called me, and it was probably May or June, and he says, Phil, I could ask permission to make you look a little bad. And I said, okay, what is that, Mark? And he says, well, it's nuanced and I'll make it won't sound as bad as it is. But he said, you had said clearly that in 2020, the number one issue was going to be finding good people. And, that was sort of a big obvious statement, but I was working with a number of clients across the country that could not grow because they couldn't find people to get the work done. And so that was a big deal. I think my biggest miss, Michelle, was that I said it was going to be the number one trend. And if I would have seen the COVID crisis coming, first of all, I think people would have either called me Nostradamus or figured that I had a hand in creating some real messes, one or the other. So I think I was way off on that, but I do think that the essence of what I had talked about was really there. It's still part of real trends and things that did happen and impacted restoration companies. One of the things that was that there was kind of a miss in that freed up was labor. Labor is a big issue. It wasn't as big of an issue because all of a sudden we went from 3% unemployment to 8 or 9% unemployment. And that's a great opportunity to find good people looking for an essential business, looking for a job that has value that they can continue to build a career in, but they're not going to be shut down by a crazy pandemic or the whims of a government or whatever else is going on. So labor was a miss, but at the same time, I think that a lot of things, you take a look at technology. Technology was one of my trends. It wasn't a big one. It would be a big one this next year, but it wasn't a big one for last year, but it was really levered by the coronavirus problems that we were dealing with. So I think, in essence, when you look back and said, okay, yeah, there was a few misses. There was a few things that I projected out that didn't necessarily come to fruition or weren't really what I would consider a major 5 or 7 issues, but they were issues and they were real. And so no, that's my thoughts on 2020 was that for the most part, it was pretty good. And if I would have got it all right, it would have been pretty scary. So.
Yes, it would have. And I do not think that hiring issue or need for skilled people is going anywhere. That's a really tough thing for everybody. So yeah. So do you see any of the trends that you've predicted in the past, maybe not even for 2020, but maybe even in 2019 or 2018, have there been any trends that you thought were coming that COVID has completely wiped out that could have been unexpected?
Well, probably not, because, one of the things is people are still doing restoration today. They were doing restoration in December of of 2019, and they're doing restoration in December of 20, and they will be in 2025. And so, yeah, there was some things that were influenced, but I did kind of look through my previous years and I missed a couple of them. I was off on a couple ideas and I made a list of them here and I kind of looked at them. One of the things I looked at 2016, I was looking at companies like Roto-Rooter, which I think is still a relevant player, I was looking at Home Depot and walking through the, seeing the shelves with air movers and dehumidifiers. And I started thinking, you know what? These outside players don't play by the same rules. There was environmental companies doing restoration who are used to working on 20% margins. And just thinking, you know what? That changes the whole scope of what restoration could be. And at the end of the day, I don't think it came to fruition. Maybe it's still sitting out there. Maybe it'll be influenced because of COVID in the future. But those things kind of simmered. In 2018, I was looking at these kind of the Facebook and social media groups, and I was also looking at what was going on over in the Middle East and seeing how they were overthrowing entire governments because of social media movements. And so I thought that, you know, they might start playing some role in changes in the industry. I still think they're relevant, but I think that one of the things that was good is when Mark Springer wrote his four-part article in Cleaning and Restoration, the other one, when he wrote his four-part article about the changes required in the industry and how our industry was not going to be recognizable, you know, that was a big moment to really take control of change in the industry. So that issue never really came about. And then in 2016, I looked at debt, and I just saw how the debt was increasing so many areas across, you know, whether it's government debt or corporate debt or anything else, and just said, you know, maybe it's going to be harder to get loans, to manage debt, to manage finances. And guess what? It became easier. Interest rates went down, money was created. And so that was a miss. All of those things, maybe I look back and said, okay, they were influenced. They were predictions that I wouldn't say were spot on, but they were interesting at the time. And there was a lot of movements in the industry that were saying, hey, maybe these would have been very relevant and could have been substantial. And then I think the only one is just the issue of labor, and labor changed. It changed from saying there's nobody out there to it's tough to find good people.
Yes. Yes, that's a good way to phrase it. And I can remember walking into Home Depot and seeing those little air movers at the time a few years ago and stacks of them everywhere and thinking, are people going to start trying to do this themselves if they have water in their houses? And that's not going to be a good journey. So far, I haven't heard that. So that's good.
I did. I had a basement water damage, went down and rented the equipment. And yeah.
Well, but you're a little different than like, you probably have an idea of what you're doing, I'm going to hope.
There's not too many certified restorers hanging out with basement water damages that don't work for a restoration company.
Probably worked out okay. Okay, so I know one of the big trends right now is mergers and acquisitions. And I was talking to a friend in the industry earlier this week who was concerned about, and this is a topic that I haven't heard of with the mergers and acquisitions conversation, but as this trend continues and these bigger companies or private equity are buying up more companies in a marketplace, could there be the risk for these even like larger independent restoration companies doing maybe $15 million a year? That's a decent size. What if their competition gets bought up in their market? Then what does that look like for their business? Can they stay afloat? I mean, especially when it comes to program work, are the programs going to start giving all the work to the big guy who bought everybody up? What do you think that looks like? Is that something coming?
Well, I think that's a real valid point. And I just think, you know, I just wrote a newsletter on that. And the reality is that if you're in a marketplace where you're just absolutely dominant and you don't have competition, I'd be concerned. I continue to build walls around me to say, you know what, I'm in a good spot, and things could change overnight. Because if you're in a market with no competitors, when you're the only dominant player, people are going to try to buy you. And when they can't buy you, then they're going to say, oh, you know what, they're going to be, whether it's the TPAs or saying, hey, we need somebody over in, I'll make up a town of West Chicago. We need somebody in West Chicago. We don't have enough people over there. My obvious question is, how much work do you have? They'd say, well, we typically get about 40 claims a month, and we could push a bunch of that your direction. Huh? Well, I'm pretty interested now. So I think that the reality is, first thing is, a competitive marketplace solves some of that problems. However, anytime, you know, with what's going on in the industry, there's so much news of mergers and acquisitions that the news facilitates more mergers and acquisitions and more companies looking at it. So I'm doing a presentation next week on March 2nd. I don't know when this will air. So on March 2nd, it's the tsunami of mergers and acquisitions. It was supposed to be equity, but it's really about mergers and acquisitions, because they're not only private equity. I think that I'm getting calls every single month from somebody saying, tell me about restoration. I'm curious whether this is a good market, or why would people want to be in it? Or tell me about the numbers and the metrics. And so there's all sorts of people looking to get in. So here's the good news, Michelle. Those big companies at this point are very, very concerned about adding locations. And none of them have done a really good job. And I don't care, the one who's been at the longest has been Belfour. And they started out as Enricon, and they were buying people up in the early 90s. Nobody has really leveraged the synergies you can get. Now, whether it's just economies of scale or whatever, the ones that are taken is the corporate contacts. And so whether you're working with CBRE or Jones Lang LaSalle or something like that, you may find that if that's your biggest client, they might go away overnight, because there's a national contract and the local person can't do anything about it. And so from a marketing standpoint, particularly large loss, big commercial stuff, that's where some of the bigger influences are. The good news is if they show up, they're not gonna take all of your TPA work if that's what you're doing, or if you develop really solid local relationship. Here's the RX to all that. Have lots of different work sources, have no more than 10 or 20% of your work coming from a single source. And when you've done that, now all of a sudden you've created a lot of barriers and a lot of sustainability to your business. And the other thing is, be a market leader, because you know what? When somebody's going to come to your town, they're going to knock on your door first. So make sure you're a market leader. And you make, here's my philosophies, and I work with all my clients, whether they're going to sell or not. It's good to have competition in your marketplace. It's really good to have competition, but keep them weak. So that just means by owning all the different resources, not just giving up clients or opportunities or options or resources. So it could happen, but I don't think that just means your work goes away overnight. Makes it harder to find good people, makes it harder in your marketing. Means you have to just tune up your business and run a really good business. So I think that, those are the things. But in those concerns, if you're not having those concerns, I think you're missing what's going on in the industry. And you should have those concerns that your market can change overnight.
Yeah. Yep. Okay. All right. So shifting gears a little bit, talking about your 2021 trend predictions, I think the very first thing you mentioned, I think, is a brand new trend. I don't know that I've seen you mention it in past articles yet. So you talked about insurance companies moving toward underwriting profit. So what does that mean? And how does that impact restoration companies?
Sure. So one of the things you have to understand is that insurance companies have two sides of their business. They have a claim side, the insurance side, and they have an investing side. And those don't operate independently. They influence each other. And so, this is something that's kind of come and gone in my thoughts. And I've written about it a little in the trends, but not specifically as this is the issue. The underwriting profit basically means that traditionally, let's say Warren Buffett and Berkshire Hathaway changed the insurance game, I believe it was in the early 90s, late 80s. And what they had done is they said, okay, typically the way an insurance company worked is they would borrow your money in premiums, they'd invest it, they'd then pay out your claim at the same or a higher dollar, but they got an investment return. And so they made money. Berkshire Hathaway came in and said, well, wait a minute, we can make money on our premiums, underwriting profit, and we can make money on claims. And they were able to leverage their profits, and it was really brilliant. And so I see that as that sort of stakes to the game now. Insurance companies are saying, you know what, if we're not making an underwriting profit, we're at a disadvantage. And so underwriting profit means I'm going to pay out less in claims than I'm going to get in premiums. And that's being driven by a couple of things that, at least in my mind, is the first one is uncertainty in the investing market. If I can make 15, 18% on the investing side of mine, I can lose a little money on my premiums. Now, if it drives down my return on that, and so it's driven down because there's no yield in the market. Gosh, this sounds like a boring finance conversation, but it's real. If I'm only getting 1.5% or 2% on government 30-year bonds, well, that isn't good. If I can, you can leverage that a little bit. If the stock market, here's one of the things I look at. The stock market, some people are saying this is going to be a fantastic year. Everything's going to be going great. And other people are saying, man, we had the great melt up and that the meltdown follows. So in reality, that creates a lot of investing uncertainty. And if there's investing uncertainty, then I'm going to look as a player in this market, a stakeholder. I'm saying the insurance companies, if they've got risk on their claims and risk on their insurance, they're going to look to say, how can I cut back my claims? How can I minimize that side of it so I can potentially make money here to make up for lower investing returns? Excuse me. So they do that. Watch for increasing deductibles. Watch for more stringent rule following in whether this is a covered claim or not. Look for maybe adjusters that are a little harder on claims. You know, some of the companies that used to be fantastic to deal with that we just all loved, and I'm not going to name any here, but they're not as good as they used to be. Mm-hmm. That's why I love going with an independent agent, because I can change my policy with the winds. But I think that in reality, if we look at the handling of claims, whether it's shifting to TPAs or just saying we're not going to pay as much, or we're going to limit what we pay, or if you look up in Canada and say they're going to do 10 and 3 or 10 and 3 with a discount coming back, all of those things are realities that can be influencing what how an insurance company can control their cost of the claim and how it can influence the restoration contractor.
Okay. All right. So I'm curious, looking at your 2021 trends or even looking beyond that, do you see anything on the horizon trend-wise that restorers might not realize is coming, but they should?
If people aren't being a student of the industry, they're going to miss this. If people study a little bit, if they spend a little bit of time, even on social media, then it's pretty obvious. The trends in technology are massive. They really are. And so I think somewhere in my statement, or maybe it was in some other post that I made on social media or something, that this is the year of technology. And it's the year of technology where it's not that we have lots of technology, it's that we have actionable technology that we can use in our business to create value, that can create efficiencies, that can make us better at what we do. Technology is advancing massively and rapidly right now. And that's being driven by a couple trends. I mean, the first one is this work from home and this virtual world, this conversation we're having right now. All this stuff, you know, 5 years ago didn't exist. And what's happening today, from estimating to digital imagery to spatial connections. And so maybe it's a photo that tells me that was a dehumidifier, and it automatically identifies that, and it automatically gives me my Xactimate code. Technology is growing massively, massively. I have my largest client that I'm working with is a little over 30 million right now in revenue. They do not have a single estimator that goes to a job site. All their estimators sit in a tech room. It's, you know, you get the Star Wars stuff up on the walls, and you get the halogen lights, and the fluorescents are off, and everybody's got four or five screens up in front of them. You know, if you're doing everything the way you've always done it, you're going to miss. So it's surprising when I talk to people, I talk to them about some of the technology that's coming, artificial intelligence, machine learning, you know, all that stuff really sounds like space age stuff, but it's here right now and it's influencing people. And so if you don't see that, if you're not studying, if you're not practicing it, and it doesn't mean that everything comes at you is good. It means there's a lot of wasted effort on some of it. And so it's trying to filter through and find those good ideas and good resources. And some of it, main industry players are integrating it, whether it's Xactimate or NextGear or Accelerate or all these other software companies are putting it right into their package. Here's the interesting thing, Michelle, to me, people just keep adding new software, new systems, new process, and they don't know how to use what they have. Isn't that unbelievable? And so, so people can easily look beyond this trend of technology. You know, the obvious trend that everybody sees and everybody's talking about is mergers and acquisitions, because it's so in your face, it's everywhere. I don't think people are going to miss that. Technology, if they're not paying attention, they can miss technology. And so I think that that's some of the reality and some of the things that perhaps we should be looking at and be aware of.
Yeah. Okay. All right. We've talked about a lot of trends here. So is there anything else that you want to touch on that we have missed so far?
Just looking through my notes here, because I guess in summary on that, Michelle, one of the things I was looking at and thinking about this is restoration is a really good spot to be. It's a good industry. You know what? People will complain because it's not the way it used to be. And I think about the way in the 1989 that we were doing things, we really wasted a lot of money and we didn't know it. And things got different and harder, but we had to get better. And it's the same thing with restoration companies today. Things are changing. It doesn't mean it's worse or bad or good or anything. It just means that things are changing. And so there's great opportunities in restoration. And I love the idea that we get to serve people in a time of need. There's a real high purpose for what we do in our businesses, and restoration is a great place to be. I'm excited about it. You know, everybody can get excited and say, I'm going to go sell my business for lots and lots of money. But then what? Maybe there's more value in doing what you're doing and doing it really well and creating an exceptional company and being a great steward of the resources you have and looking out for the families of the people who work for you and all of those things. You know, so I guess my final point is, yes, things are changing, but we can be successful in that, and we can create a great organization, we can create a great company, and we can have something that they can add tons of value to us personally and to our lives. And so I love restoration. Restoration is a great place to be regardless of what happens with the changes.
I fully agree. It's a great industry and great people. So thank you, Phil, for your time. I really appreciate it. For those who are watching, thanks for checking this out. Check out Phil's articles on rnrmagonline.com, and I will see you on a future video. Thanks, Phil.
You're welcome. I appreciate your time, Michelle.
Thank you.